So I'm here for the vote with Sophie Cook. So you're a photographer, Premier League photographer.
Well, I was.
Yeah, you were. Yeah. But you also, you're an activist, LGBT activist. You're an author. You're quite a lot. You're a speaker as well.
I know, sort of. A never-ending... former latest TV presenter.
Former latest TV presenter as well. That should have come first, actually, shouldn't it? But you're going to be managing a football team, or player managing a football team, Football United, which is on Sunday.
Sunday of Brighton Pride, August the 4th.
Yeah, August 4th, and it's 3 o'clock kickoff, and it's going to be at the White Hawk Ground, which is the Terapura Ground.
Yeah.
Tell us all about it.
Well, I'm the player manager of a team called Rainbow United. Rainbow Rovers. Yeah. The event's called Football United. Basically, my team is made up of LGBT activists, LGBT players from various teams around the country, all sort of Sunday League sort of sides. And we're taking on a team of ex-Premier League pros, including Champions League winners,
yes,
and all, lots of Man United players. We've even got an Albion player in there, Guy Butters.
Yeah, Guy Butters. Yeah, you've got David May.
David May, so Champions League winner.
Champions,
yeah,
League winner, wouldn't he, from '99? Yeah. You've got Lee Hendry as well.
Yeah, from Villa.
Former Villa player. You've got Kevin Davidson Bolton. This is reliving my childhood. Yeah. You know?
Well, that's it. These are the players that I watched as a kid.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The thing is, I'm player manager. I'm going to be the oldest player on the pitch, unfortunately, but I should have actually put some older people in my team just so I looked sprightly. But as player manager, part of my tactic is I'm going to put myself on, stand on centre circle, and tell my players to pass to me. Otherwise, I'll substitute them.
Yeah, and you're going to get a tap and you'll score, right?
Oh,
I'll put a bet on.
No, I'm going to do a proper Giggsy run, go past three of them, and then curl it into the top right corner.
Yeah, so. And it's all for a good cause, isn't it? So
yeah,
it's Pride weekend.
It's all to raise money for the Rainbow Fund. Like so many activities over Pride weekend, because the Rainbow Fund does so much good in our community, supporting LGBT and HIV supporting organisations. So it's a really good cause and a great thing for people to get out to. I mean, Rainbow Rovers, we've got a brand new amazing kit that's been designed by David Strigley, the Turner Prize nominated artist.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a great day. We've got DJs on, and it's well worth people coming down. 3 o'clock kickoff at the Terapura.
Yeah. So can you turn up on a day? Because I know you can for Whitehawk.
Yeah.
Whitehawk.
Well, it's better if people pre-book their tickets through the website. So if they go to whitehawkfc.com, I think it is.
Yeah.
And they can pre-book their tickets there, because that way they're guaranteed to getting in on the day. But there will be a possibility of people coming up on the day, and just coming in and enjoying the fun.
Yeah. And I know that Latest TV are going to be covering it as well. William's going to be covering it for us. Moving on to Pride then, because it's on Pride weekend. Mm. It's never been more important, has it, to celebrate LGBT rights? Because they are under threat, I think, in the UK, which I never thought I'd be saying that, but I think they are. So.
Well, I came out 4 years ago, and the world seemed like it was actually getting somewhere then. In those 4 years, the world seems to have taken a step backwards in so many different ways. We've had the election of Donald Trump, which has massively affected LGBT rights in the States. And over here, we've now got a new prime minister who has been known to use very derogatory terms for LGBT people. And basically that sort of homophobia and transphobia seems to extend throughout his cabinet. We're getting challenges. We're seeing that the protests in Birmingham about sort of LGBT education in schools.
Which is totally misunderstood. It's going to be legal anyway from next September to promote or to educate.
Well, not promote. That's language of Section 28. Yeah,
but to educate people on LGBT rights. So that will be law next year anyway. I'm surprised it wasn't law before. So, but I think it's been misunderstood what is being... What the syllabus is, right?
Yeah, and the thing is, we're also seeing the same with education about trans people. And we've seen some very, very high-profile campaigns aimed at attacking transgender rights. And a lot of the rhetoric being used around these campaigns against LGBT and trans education in schools mirrors the language of Section 28, when it was illegal to promote homosexuality as a legitimate lifestyle choice in any school or anything. And we can't go back to those days. That was, I went to school during the days of Section 28, and it made it very difficult for any young person to come out, and it made it even more impossible for them to get any support.
Yeah. So, and that's what we're here to celebrate, you know, the rights of LGBT people over the weekend. So that's what's important. It's about having fun, having a party, but also celebrating
making sure
that people understand that the battle's not finished.
I mean, Pride started as a riot, and it's important to remember the rights that we fought for the last, for 100 years or so, leading up to the partial decriminalisation of homosexuality in 1967. Those rights can be easily taken away from us. And whilst we need to keep that fight for maintaining those rights and extending them in this country, it's also important to remember that there are other countries in the world where it's still illegal to be gay, and gay people still face possibility of being sent to prison or even a death sentence. And we need to stand in solidarity with those countries, because until everyone around the entire world is free and equal, none of us are free or equal.
Yeah, and I know you've travelled abroad, haven't you? You went to Russia.
I went to Russia last year during the World Cup. That was it was in conjunction with the World Cup. Having worked in football and been very involved in LGBT activism within the game, I went to Russia to speak to a conference of LGBT activists the day after the semi-final, and leading up to the conference, the FSB, the Russian secret police, closed down our venue 3 times. Every time the venue got wind that it was an LGBT event, the rug would be pulled from under us. The organisers had the FSB following them around.
Yeah.
And travelling out there as a trans woman on my own and arriving at Moscow at 2 o'clock in the morning was a bit nervy.
Yeah.
But the Russian people were amazing. The city is absolutely beautiful. And the thing is, out on the streets of Moscow, I didn't experience any more stares than I would get on the streets of sort of Southampton or Portsmouth. And I was walking around with a Russian friend, and occasionally he would say, "Oh, so-and-so was talking about you." And they were saying, it was always more about interest wanting to know more rather than someone sort of slagging me off. So it was very interesting. I think that the Russian people have an openness towards diversity that maybe their leadership and their government doesn't.
Yeah, and that's what you found. Did you get to see any football while you were out there?
Yeah, I got to the semi-final. I was sat in the posh seats just behind Gareth Southgate. It's sort of it's good to be out there as a guest at FIFA.
Yeah.
Oh, it was absolutely amazing. And when Kieran Trippier scored near the start.
Yes.
And for an hour, football was... when he scored that goal, I actually started crying. I'm there. I'm sat next to the referee from the 1970 World Cup match between England and Brazil, the Pelé-Bobby Moore match. And we're chatting away about the game, and the ball went in. And I'm thinking, I'm sat at a World Cup semi-final and England are about to go through to the final, and it's like,
so we thought,
the guys did absolutely amazingly, and in the Women's World Cup this year as well, the Lionesses did a cracking job, and it's always important to remember that it's not, football isn't just a men's game.
We cover a lot of women's football, and Lewis Women FC, a couple of the Albion ladies as well.
And in fact, the Football United match at Whitehawk, that's a mixed gender match. It's going to be the highest profile mixed gender match possibly ever in this country.
Yeah, so, both teams?
Just my team. We were trying to get some female players on the ex-pros team, but we couldn't actually get any for that team at the moment.
Yeah.
On the Rainbow Rovers, I think we've got like three trans women in the team. We've got a couple of cisgender women. We've got gay guys. We've got straight guys. We've got, good old mixture.
Good.
Like Pride should be.
Yes. Join us for the second half with Sophie. We're going to be talking about her book and the rest of her career as well. And as well as that, we'll be talking about Football Zone and ACF Bournemouth. Join us soon. So welcome back to Vote. I'm here with Sophie Cook. I'm going to be talking about the book.
My book.
So yeah, it's Not Today, isn't it?
It's the first one was called Not Today, How I Chose Life, which is it's basically my autobiography up until the day that I left politics. And it's about my lifelong battle with my mental health and coming to terms with the suicidal and self-harming feelings that I'd struggled with since I was a teenager.
Yes, so should we talk about the first one first?
Yeah.
So how did that journey, how was that journey up until you standing for candidate for, and almost actually getting nearly 20,000 votes?
21,000 votes, 21,000
votes.
Yeah.
So just tell us a bit about the start of that journey then.
Well, I'd known that I was trans since I was about 7 years old, and I first tried to take my own life when I was about 12. So, and I'm now sort of 26. So that was 40 years of dealing with suicidal feelings. Yeah. I joined the Air Force at 16. At the age of 18, I saved a colleague's life when he lost an arm in an explosion. That led to post-traumatic stress. And then a lifetime of working in Saudi Arabia, coming home, working in football, and all the while in the background having that demon that was just sort of feeding me negativity and feeding me sort of the idea that the world would be a better place without me.
Yeah.
And then in 2015, I came out whilst I was club photographer for FC Bournemouth, finally transitioned, managed to start living as my true self. But still the demon was there and sort of tormenting me. And it was really interesting. Through the process of writing the book, I actually did a lot of healing. It's like a form of therapy, really. And because the title comes from a philosophy that I came up with for myself a couple of years ago to keep myself safe. And that is, I know that one day I'll kill myself because I don't know how to stop feeling this way, but it won't be today. And in the meantime, I'm going to do the best I can to enjoy every single day. And then on the day that I die, in many, many years' time, I'll look back and realise that I didn't get around to doing it. And that's why I've got Not Today tattooed on my wrist.
Yeah.
Because what that did was it gave me permission to have those days when I felt suicidal, because I had no control over when they came. But it took away the guilt and the shame, because the guilt and the shame sort of magnify its ability to hurt you. But by taking away the guilt and shame, the effect of my suicidal days became greatly diminished. They started to come a lot less often. And when they came, it allowed me to move on from it quicker, because by taking away the guilt and shame, it allowed me to think about things logically rather than emotionally.
Yeah.
And all the time you're thinking about the fact that you've got mental health problems and suicidal and self-harm feelings, if all the time you're thinking about it emotionally, you get into this spiral. But as soon as you can take the emotion out of it and start thinking about it logically, then it's much easier to actually move beyond that dark place and actually find a healthier, more positive path for your life. And that's made a massive difference to me.
Yeah. That was kind of a release, really, then, writing that book, because there's a lot of talk now about people expressing their emotions more. We do a lot of mental health issues in the news. So did you find that difficult previously then? But what made you get to that stage where you wanted to kind of talk to people and to talk about how you feel, because people find it really difficult, don't they?
Yeah. When I came out 4 years ago, back in 2015, I realised that I could either hide and just try and get on with my life, or I could use the fact that I had some degree of public profile through working in football to try and raise issues that I thought were important and try and change things. And I realised very quickly that the greatest way to improve people's mental health is actually to remove the stigma from it. So that they don't feel that guilt and shame, so that they can actually start talking about it more openly without that fear of being judged for it. And in fact, I'm busy writing my second book at the moment, and this is the follow-on to Not Today, How I Chose Life. This new one's called Not Today, Losing My Addictions. Yeah. Because I realised that the same techniques and philosophies that I'd used to overcome my mental health demons would also help me to overcome my addictions. Now, the thing is, all of us have trauma and pain and loss in our lives, and that leaves holes in our soul.
Yeah.
And then we try and use things to fill those holes, whether it's alcohol, sex, drugs, rock and roll, working too much, shopping, chocolate, food, any of these things. We use it to try and fill those holes in our soul, but actually all they're doing is trying to numb the pain. So what I'm doing at the moment is I've given up meat, I've given up alcohol. So I'm trying to fill those holes in my soul with things that are positive, things that are good for me. Yeah. Like I live in Lancing. Every morning I go out and spend 2 hours walking up and down the beach picking up litter. Because,
yes, I've seen
because that feeds my soul. That's sort of, it's true mindfulness, because you're not thinking about anything else. And service is a great way of actually feeling. I mean, if anyone does the 12 steps through AA, service is a very big part of it, actually, thinking about the greater good rather than your own good.
Yes, yeah. So you found it really helpful. The way you talk about it is beautiful as well, I have to say. And the book is well written as well.
Thank you very much.
Coming into politics a bit, because the first bit certainly covers that, how did you find the world of the rough and tumble of politics? Let's put it that way.
Well, I mean, I went into politics for the 2017 general election, and some might call me naive, but I truly believe that sort of if you went into politics with the right intentions, you could actually change the world.
Yes. You need politics. We need politics, don't we?
Unfortunately, the system is made up that politics is quite essential to it. Yeah. But I thought that by going in pure of heart and sort of with the greatest intent, I could actually make a difference. And did make a difference. I mean, in the 2017 general election, The Labour Party had pretty much decided that it was going to lose before it even started, and therefore didn't put a lot of resources into very many places. I was the candidate in East Worthing and Shoreham, and all of our activists were sent to Hove to support Peter Kyle. So we didn't even have our own people to help our campaign. We had no money, and it was essentially a five-week campaign leading up to the election.
Yeah.
In 2015, we only got 9,000 votes there, but I mean, I remember when I first went there, someone turned around to me and went, "You do realise this isn't Brighton? No one's going to vote for a trans woman here." But I went out, I spoke to people, I stood up for the things that I believed in, and 20,882 people came out and voted for me and the Labour Party.
And what's Tim Lawton's majority there?
Well, it was 15,000, now it's down to about 5,000.
Yes, so you cut it to 5,000.
Yeah, I mean, it was the biggest swing anywhere in the country. It's the most votes any trans candidate has ever received.
I didn't mean it. So that was the biggest swing, was it?
Yeah.
Because I know Canterbury was, which went Labour, and Kensington Chelsea, of course, went Labour. But you had the biggest swing.
Mm.
Right. Wow, that's impressive.
But unfortunately, one of the things is that if you make a seat winnable, then all the people that didn't want it before suddenly want it.
Yes.
So it turned into quite a painful experience following the election.
You don't have to go into detail, but what exactly happened there then? Because
some people decided that they didn't want me, personally didn't want me, and they set out with a whispering campaign.
Right.
And that's the thing about politics, sort of. There's a great quote, and I used it in the book, a great quote that's attributed to Tony Blair. When he turned around to David Miliband and said, smile at someone's face and get someone else to stab them in the back. And basically that pretty much sums up my experience of politics.
Yeah.
It's unfortunate because I really truly believe that just by being pure of heart, you could actually try and make a difference in politics, but it would appear that that's not quite the case.
So would you stand for a seat again, maybe as an independent or Democrat?
I never say I've not as a liberal right. Democrat, that's for sure. I'm one of these people that remember what they actually did during coalition, how they supported and enabled austerity. So no, never a liberal Democrat. Who knows? I mean, politics. I mean, my book ends the day, my first book ends the day after I left politics, because the way they were treating me actually took me to the verge of suicide. It was so vindictive, so nasty, and so personal that I don't know if I'd ever actually want to go back to that world.
Yeah.
I went into politics to help people. I was helping people before I went into politics, and I continue to help people now. I mean, we're in the process of setting up our own charity, the Sophie Cook Foundation, which is aimed at doing LGBT mental health education in schools.
Yeah.
And I think that's really important, but I'll never say never.
Yeah. Just very, very briefly, how can people get your book? Just your website.
Yeah, basically, if they go to my website, which is www.sophiecook.me.uk, or follow me on social media, which is at Sophie Cook Talks.
We'll leave it there. Thanks, Sophie, for coming. All the best.
My pleasure.
And we'll catch up again soon, no doubt.
Cheers.
Cheers. Thanks a lot.